Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson two of the platform specific series of my 68,000 programming tutorials. Now, last week we had a look at the X68000, and this week we're going to look at bitmap graphics on the Atari ST. Now, the Atari ST uses a memory-based screen, so we're just using a bank of our memory to actually store the bitmap data of the screen, and we just write the data into that memory and it will immediately appear on the screen. Now, the Atari ST has a 320 by 200 pixel screen, and it's 16 colours. What is quite unusual about the Atari ST is although it uses bitplanes like a lot of systems, which is where 8 pixels are stored within a single byte, but there are multiple bytes that add extra bits to the colour definition, on the Atari ST, rather than being stored in individual bytes or being stored in individual banks of memory, they're actually stored in words. So there is a pair of bytes that make up a word for 16 consecutive pixels, and then there are 3 more words that make up the other bits of the colours. Now let's have a look at that because it is quite tricky and it does mean selecting memory locations for drawing our graphics data can be quite tricky. So if you imagine our Chibico sprite here is 48 pixels wide. Now the pixels that will be contained in the first line of this strip here would all be contained within a single byte. Now we're going to call this byte AA and the neighbouring 8 pixels here we're going to call lowercase AA. So these make up a single word here. Now, of course, if these are 16 colour pixels, then we're going to need 4 bits to define each one of the colours. And when we look at these in memory, if you imagine our memory for our screen started at hexadecimal 10,000 here, then the first bit plane of these 2 bytes making up a word would be at the first memory address. At the second memory address, 2 bytes along, would be the second bit plane. So these 2 combined together would allow us a total of 4 colours. And then there would be another 2 bit planes to make the 4 bit planes in total that we need to make up the 16 colours. Now, if you're not familiar with what bitplanes are, you don't really need to understand them too much at this stage because if you're using my AcuSprite editor, it will export in a format we can work with, and if you use the example code today, then you'll be able to get the bitmap from that AcuSprite editor onto the screen without any problems. So essentially, the 16 pixels here use a total of 8 bytes in consecutive memory here. But then the neighbouring 16 pixels in this column here follow on 8 bytes down from the start of our memory here. And then the strip here will use this memory here. Now, of course, we're only talking about one row here. So it's only the 16 pixels on the top row that would be in this memory and the 16 pixels in this memory and the 16 pixels here in this memory. When we get down to the next line of our screen, this will follow on directly below the first line of our screen. We're going to see some more of that later, so don't worry about that too much for now. So we're working with a bitplane screen and we're working in words on the Atari ST. How do we actually set up the memory? Well, we have some hardware memory mapped registers that we need to set up to do things, and you can see them just here. We need to specify the base of the memory. We need to specify 2 bytes to do this. Now, one thing I want to point out early on, if you're looking at other tutorials, there are 2 different ways these memory mapped registers are shown. The 68000 uses a 24-bit address bus, which means only 3 of the 4 bytes within an address are actually looked at. So, for example, this address here, FF8200, might be shown as FFFF8200 in some documentation. However, because the top byte isn't used as part of the address, they will both work just the same. But that also has some relevance to selecting our memory address for the start of our screen. You see, we can specify a high byte and a mid byte, but we should also have a low byte if we're a 24-bit address. However, we can't specify that on the Atari ST. So what we need to do is we need to start our screen at a base address where the low byte is 0. And we will have to do a little bit of a trick to achieve that. Now, as well as defining the screen position, we have 16 palette definitions that we can define here. We're going to look at that in a later lesson, so don't worry about that too much for now. And we have various screen modes, and we write to this address here to set the screen mode, defined by the least significant 2 bits here. And the one we're going to be using is 320 by 200 at 4 bits per pixel, which is 16 colours. And we just write 0 to this address to do that. But we also have 640 by 200 at 2 bits per pixel, or 640 by 400 at 1 bit per pixel, but we're not going to use those today. So let's have a look at the actual source code that we're going to use to create a screen and actually draw to it. Now on the Atari ST, the first thing we need to do is we need to actually switch the processor into supervisor mode. We can't write to some of these registers in our regular user mode. And the way we're going to switch to supervisor mode is using TRAP14 with parameter hexadecimal 26, which is called superexec. This sets supervisor execution and it will turn the processor into supervisor mode, and then it will start the address we specify. So we're specifying the address ST start here. So what will effectively happen is this will turn supervisor mode on and then call this address. And the first thing we're going to do is screen init, and then from here will be the rest of our code. So screen init is just down here. And what we're going to do is we're going to turn the screen to our 320 by 200, that's a mistake, 320 by 200, 4-bit plane color mode. And that's going to turn our graphics on. But then what we need to do is we need to specify the memory that we're going to have storing the screen data. I've defined this definition called screen mem here, but where is that? Well, it's in the RAM area of the code here. And we're going to use quite an unusual definition here. We've got this command section BSS. This tells the assembler that we're going to have a block of data that we once defined rather specially. Now, as far as I can find out, BSS stands for block started by symbol, which doesn't really mean a lot. It seems like it's really a legacy thing that has no longer really means anything other than BSS anymore. What it literally means is that we're defining areas of memory with certain sizes, but they don't actually appear in the data of the executable file that we're compiling to. They are created in RAM once the program is loaded by the operating system, and they're initialized to zero. So we're defining blocks with this DS command. We can't use DCL to define this screen base, for example, because we can't define a value, we can only define a size. So we're defining here some memory. Now, the screen needs 32,000 bytes of memory, but if you remember, we need the base byte to be a zero, and we can't be sure that we will be byte aligned when the operating system allocates us this memory. So what we're doing is we're allocating an extra 256 bytes, and then we're going to reset the bottom byte of screen memory so that we know we're zero aligned, so we can meet the requirements of the graphics hardware. And we can see we're doing this just here. So what we're doing is we're loading the address of screen mem into D0. We're then adding 255 to it. This means we're now going to be at the bottom end of our extra allocation. We then clear the bottom byte of D0, and this means we're now byte aligned within the area allocated by screen memory. This gives us a good address to use for the screen. And so what we're doing next is we're storing this in screen base here, and this will be used later on for when we actually want to draw things to the screen. Now, what we need to do next is another little bit of a tricky thing for our parameters. Now, even though we are using two word-based parameters here, it's only the second byte in these two word parameters that is actually used. So we need to move the high and medium into the right positions. Now, when we get to this point, D0 is currently in the format 00, and then 4 bytes of our address, and these bottom 2 bytes we already know will be 0. But what we actually need to do is we need to shift C and D in this example here right by a single byte to this position here, so that this byte and this byte will make up the top 2 bytes of our address, because we know the bottom byte will be 0. So that's what we're doing here. We're shifting it along, and now it's in the correct format to move in long format into the address here. And so that's specifying to the graphics hardware the address of our data. We're now in a position to start actually working. We then set up some very basic starting colors here just so the screen will work if we're testing things. The example we're going to be using today is going to set a special palette, and we're going to look at how to set palettes with that code later on. So now I think we're at a point where we actually want to see the example. So let's fire it up. So here's the example. We're showing the hello world message, but the thing I want to show you today is really the Chibico character here. You can see we've got Chibico here, and it's drawn in 4 colors, but we're actually in 16 color mode, and we're drawing this sprite from a file that we've loaded from the disk. So here's the basic code that's doing the work. We've got some initialization here as well, just setting the screen position. We're using this command get screen pos. What this does is it loads A6 with the destination in memory according to an XY position that we specified. Now we're specifying 1 byte across the screen and 32 lines down the screen, and then we're drawing to the screen, but we have to do it in 4-bit planes. Now the format I've actually exported in is actually the Amiga format, which is where we're using 4 consecutive bytes for each of the 4-bit planes. Now, as I said, the Atari ST actually uses 4 consecutive words for the 4-bit planes. Now, in theory, there's no reason why we couldn't export in that format and just write straight to the screen very easily. But there is a disadvantage to that, because we'd only be able to position the sprite with an accuracy of 16 pixels. But with this example, we're actually able to select an X position by 8 pixel chunks, which was great for grime 68,000 because that uses 8x8 tiles. That wasn't coincidental, of course. So we're using the Amiga format, and then we are converting to the Atari ST. So what we're doing is we're loading in the byte for the first bit plane, and we're loading it into A6. Then we're loading in the byte for the second bit plane, and we're offsetting by 2 bytes. And that's because the first byte was being written to here, but the second byte is being written to this byte here, 2 bytes along. And the following bit planes will write to this position and this position, 4 bytes along and 6 bytes along as well. Then we're adding 4 to get to the third bit plane and 6 to get to the fourth bit plane. At this point, we've now finished the first byte, so we add 1 to the memory destination. So we're now pointing at this byte here. We then repeat the entire procedure again, writing in the second byte. But then when we find we're actually working on an odd byte, so we wrote our first byte to here, and then we incremented by 1, and we wrote our second byte to here. But now we need to move along all the way to this byte here, so we're effectively jumping from this position here to this position here. And to achieve that, we need to add 7 bytes to our writing address. Now, 1 has already been added here, so we're adding an extra 6 here to make our 7. And that will move us along to the next word-aligned set of bytes with bitplane 0. So this is our loop that is moving the data to the screen. And you can see we're actually loading in the sprite definition here, and we're using the Amiga format sprite. They're the same format, and that will work just fine. Of course, a lot of the work is actually being done by the get screen pos command. So how does that work? Well, you can see it here. It's not too complicated, really. So what we're doing is we're loading in the screen base, which is the definition of what we backed up here once we'd worked it out before. We could recalculate it, but it's faster to do it this way. Then what we're doing is we're ignoring the low bit, and we're storing that in D1. Next, what we're doing is we're taking the low bit and we're storing that in D3. Then we're moving D1 left by 2 bytes. And the reason for this is we need to jump 8 bytes for every odd byte that we're writing to, because, as I say, the bytes are stored in pairs, and so we need to do that. And then we're adding the low byte here so that we can select the odd or the even byte within the word here. So this is allowing us to select an individual byte within the x-axis, because we are splitting it up like this. And then we add those together to get the correct X position on the line we want, but we still need to select the Y line. Now the Y lines are consecutive, so each line is 160 bytes below the last one. So all we're doing is we're using the multiply command to multiply the Y position we want by 160, and we're adding that to the address. So the base address plus the X offset plus the Y offset is the destination we want to write to. So it's pretty straightforward there, relatively speaking. Now, one other thing that I will discuss just as an added bonus, you may want to do a V-blank wait. What this is where your game is running. If your game's running too fast, you might want to wait until the screen refreshes to lock your game down to 50-60 Hertz. Now, what you can do is there's 2 options on the Atari ST. Personally, I'm not so happy with either of them, so I'm going to call it out and see if anyone knows a better one. But there's 1 option is to use Trap 14. This is the XBIOS trap, and we can send command hexadecimal 25 to it. It will wait until VBlank occurs. That will work just fine. Our other alternative is to use another firmware-based solution. The firmware automatically updates a counter at memory address hexadecimal 462. So we can just read that in, wait till it changes, and when it changes, we know a VBlank must have occurred. Now, I say I'm not particularly happy with either of those. The reason is I don't like using the firmware. I believe the Atari ST actually uses the same multifunction device as the X68000, and on that I was able to detect when VBlank occurred from a flag within that device, but it doesn't seem, according to the documentation, that that's possible. So I'm wondering if someone out there knows the Atari ST and can recommend a memory address or a port that I can probe and manually check if VBlank is currently occurring. Because as I say, I don't really like using the firmware functions just as a sort of matter of course. I like to know that I'm doing things that won't rely on the firmware still working okay, in case I've corrupted it, for example, which has been known to happen before now. So there we go. So that's how we can get a bitmap to the screen, and how we can select positions, and how we can initialize the screen. Now, there's a much more simple example here without all the extra kludge in this one, because this one is a multi-platform one, but this just shows it very basically. So you can see really all that you need to do for the Atari ST. Also, of course, there is an alternate version of this code. Now, this code will actually draw the characters to the screen. It's basically the same code, just regurgitated and designed to work with 1 bit per pixel font. I'm not going to go into it today because I think it's just going to be more reiterating the same, and I think it'll be quite boring. So we're going to just skip that for now. Hopefully you found this interesting and it's given you a bit of an introduction to the Atari ST graphics. Now, if you don't know the Atari ST, it is important to notice it doesn't have hardware sprites. So you are going to have to do everything in software if you want. Personally, I have no problems with that. I quite like that way of doing things, but that is just one thing something to bear in mind if you're not familiar with the Atari ST. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this week's lesson. We're going to be doing the Neo Geo probably next week, so please follow me for that. Anyway, thanks for watching today, and goodbye.